This is performance on test, four-year high school graduation rates, for the first time, progress in English language proficiency. That's actually a huge win. That means you need to ensure that students are gaining English proficiency. Now, the bottom two are really key as well because they're optional. So again, for your high schools, you have the four-year graduation rates. For your middle and elementary schools, you have this optional indicator number four. Student engagement, educator engagement, student access to and completion of advanced coursework, post-secondary readiness, and school climate and safety. I want to underscore, as a coalition, we chose to oppose this law. We opposed the law because we were concerned about any step back or any unnecessary restrictions on the federal role in education or federal oversight in education. Because this law gives a lot of power back to states and districts and limits the federal, the role or ability of the federal government to intervene, to tell states that you're not going far enough, that your pretensions are not strong enough. It doesn't completely eliminate the federal role, but the federal role is diminished dramatically. So as a coalition, we oppose the law. However, we did secure a lot of wins in this law, a lot of funding for discipline alternatives, and a key win is this. For the first time in history, a school can be ranked and evaluated based on overall school climate and safety. But what's key about this is how do you define school climate and safety? If you have a district that's saying, we've improved our school climate and safety because we've added SROs, that's not good. So what's key for us is that we work with the states and the districts in telling them, how do we define school climate and safety? So we are going to break out into groups soon, but one key thing I want you to think about, not only to work with your state plan team to get them to select school climate and safety, and I do want to add, it's not that these other indicators aren't important. Yes, it's important to have student engagement, educator engagement, post-secondary readiness, et cetera. Those are all important things. But if you don't have positive and inclusive school climates, you won't be ready for post-secondary readiness because you'll be pushed out into the juvenile justice system. And if you have positive, inclusive school climates, you should have student engagement and educator engagement. Okay, so that's the argument for why school climate and safety is such a key indicator. It encompasses all these other indicators. So that's why we're urging states and districts to choose this indicator. And also, we want to hold districts and states accountable. If you are a school that is continuing to violate the civil rights of students and push them out of school and discriminate against them and target them, you should be held accountable. You should be held accountable for that. But what's key for us is you break out into the groups and talk about your work with in drafting your state plans is, how do you define this? And honestly, it might be defined differently in Minnesota than it is in California. It might be defined differently in Mississippi. You might have very different factors that you want your schools and district or states and districts to take into account. And finally, there's another optional indicator. We're also pushing that this be school climate and safety for schools, okay? So we want to talk, this is why the state plan is so critical. This is your accountability system. Each state will differ. Each state has its choice again, because this indicator is optional. They have the choice for what they pick, right? So that's why it's so important to be involved early on in the process to encourage your state to adopt this indicator, but ensure that it properly implements this indicator. And yes, there was a question, young lady was so patient, and then we'll go over here.
Okay, thank you. I know that under No Child Left Behind, students were able to transfer out of a low performing school that's priority or focus in New York State. PAC like has worked on this. So I was just curious whether or not you know if that is something that still is part of this new the ESSA.
Like that?
The transfer, the ability to transfer.
Sure, that's a good question.
Parent choice.
Yeah,
a lot of people fought for these parental choice options. I believe that's still here, but what's important is it's going to differ by your district and by your state. There's so much more flexibility here for states and local districts. And so right now, what states and districts are focused on is drafting their state plans. Then what they will do after the state plan is drafted, let me just go back here. After the state plan is drafted and your schools are ranked, there will be a process to develop a district level, what's called a needs assessment. This is supposed to be a participatory process. In developing your needs assessment, you should, again, we say should, this isn't the law, but we have to ensure it's in practice. You should have parents, community stakeholders, and others engaged in drafting your needs assessment, your interventions for your low performing schools. That is supposed to be an inclusive process. So you're defining as a community stakeholder and advocate what the intervention should be. So if you have a school, for instance, that is doing poorly in terms of school climate and safety, you can push to say, hey, you have to do more professional development training on implicit bias for your teachers, right? And I also do want to underscore too, for this whole process, the law requires meaningful input of stakeholders. That's in the law. But again, that is not happening in practice. So we have to hold states and districts accountable now as they're beginning this process to include everyone. Yes.
Sharing your PowerPoint with the membership.
Yes, and actually I have a much more detailed PowerPoint. This is the short version. For those who were in the session on Friday, we have a very much more detailed walkthrough, step-by-step PowerPoint that we will share as well. So we'll share both versions of the slides. You guys, this law is over 1,000 pages.
Right.
It's 1,000 pages. That's why in the chart that we've given everyone, we've indicated the page numbers of the different provisions that are really critical. We want you to be able to walk in. When you go into your state plan team meeting, we want you to be able to go in. If they tell you, oh, I'm sorry, as a parent, you have no place in this process, we want you to be able to say, no, actually, per section 1111B, X, whatever, I do have a role in this process. So we've been very specific in the different provisions, what they allow, and what's important, particularly for stakeholder input. And there are a lot of provisions about parent and community engagement as well. Yes, Marie. Okay, that's really important. They might not call the group the state plan group. They might call it the informational session, et cetera, and consider that enough meaningful, quote unquote, input of parents and community stakeholders. So that's really important, Marika, making sure that what you're participating in is the actual drafting of the state plan. And we put on the very last slide, you guys, just some resources as well. I know many of you already know your state, and I'm sorry, this is not showing up very well, but we know many of you already know who many of your state decision makers are, but there is a group called the Council of Chief State School Officers, or CCSSO. They have a search engine where you can go in, put your state in, and it will tell you all of your key folks. It will give you their names, addresses, email addresses, phone numbers, so you can contact them directly, so you don't have to guess who may or may not be drafting the state plan, and ask them. Even if you call them and they're like, I have no idea who's doing the state plan, they should know. And make sure they give you that information. If they tell you they don't have it or they can't give it, you tell them that's a violation of the law because it's required in the law. Yes, ma'am.
Correct, it's across everywhere, I'm not too sure, but in the state of Oregon, we do not hold our kids back.
Yeah, that's a good question. It sounds like something your state is going to have to address in its state plan, as it's developing its state plan. What kind of mechanisms, especially as they look at, if we go back to the accountability indicators, as they look at these four-year graduation rates, what's happening and leading up to, hold on, let me make sure I get the right, and leading up to meeting this four-year high school graduation requirement. The actual law is much more detailed. It talks about the credits, what the proficiency standards. States are also required to develop what are called challenging state academic standards. So I'm sure that in drafting those standards, your state is going to have to define what that actually means. Okay, does it mean you have proficiency in reading, math, and what level, how do you measure this? Another thing I would encourage you to do, and I know that this is way on the back end, but once your state has ranked, it's and again, No Child Left Behind is gone. That's gone, that's no longer law. But once your state has ranked its higher performing, lower performing students, you can develop, you can recommend from the needs assessment that they address what's happening with reading. And I think folks in Mississippi, do you have a literacy law? Or third grade promotion act? I would talk to some other state folks too, because this might be something you address in state law too. But ensuring it doesn't have that punitive effect. Yeah, because we have to be careful of unintended consequences as well. And I'm sure that that's kind of what they were thinking in terms of having that law where you couldn't hold students back. But you're also doing them a disservice by pushing them on and they don't have the content on it.
So yeah, as I was listening to you, I actually agreed. So Ohio is one of those states that have the third grade reading guarantee. I believe Mississippi is another state that has that. But at least in Ohio, our law only penalizes the child. And the child, like you said, is held back. They're the teachers and the administrative staff, they are supposed to be implementing different plans for young people. But one of the things that we know for sure is that knowing how to read doesn't start in third grade. It actually starts much earlier. And so I would encourage parents, I would encourage you as an educator, like you said, that you're meeting with parents in high school, but if you have the time or know other educators who are just as passionate about children learning, I would encourage you to get with a parent group or parent organization in Portland. I know Portland's Parent Union is there. And really get parents together to start organizing them and letting them know that it's really important for them to make sure that their kids are reading. But and also, and I know it's not popular, but they need to stay on those teachers. Because we passed out a report in our institutional racism course talking about teacher expectations. And I know Oregon is very white, Ohio is too. So if the teachers are looking at black students, and if you can let me know if the students you're talking about are primarily black or not, but if they're looking at black students that don't think that they can learn, have the ability to learn, that's a problem too. So this is definitely bigger and multifaceted, and it's gonna take organizing.
Absolutely. And also, we don't, I think that's a good question in terms of how does that overlap with this, with Every Student Succeeds Act or ESSA. We hope that you keep in mind your ongoing work. We don't want ESSA to be just such a like a separate distraction. We know everyone already has a lot on your plate. You're dealing with a lot right now at the local level. So we hope that there's a way that we can align and coordinate ongoing advocacy efforts so you're not stretched so thin. We get it. Everyone has a lot of